And I'll keep praying for you during this very special time. We gather knowing and trusting that the Lord is present and that in the Lord's mercy all things will work out for the good of each sister, for the good of the congregation, the sister servants in the back part of Mary, and for the good of the church. And so I'd ask as we begin this celebration of Holy Eucharist, that each of you make an intention for this Mass, that you think right now what it is that you hope from this time of the chapter, what is it that you dream, what is it that you expect, what is it that you're looking for, wanting and desiring, as we enter into this sacred time in your congregation, this special moment. We know the Lord is present, so ask of Him what it is you desire individually and as a community of sisters. Trust that the Lord will hear, that the Lord will answer. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the consolation of the Holy Spirit be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. who through the grace of adoption chose us to be children of light. Grant, we pray, that we may not be wrapped in the darkness of error, but always be seen to stand in the bright light of truth. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Thank you. A reading from the second letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, as you excel in every respect, in faith, discourse, knowledge, all earnestness, and in the love we have for you, may you excel in this gracious act also. For you know the gracious act of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, for your sake he became poor, so that by his poverty you might become rich. Not that others should have relief while you are burdened, but that as a matter of equality, your abundance at the present time should supply their needs, so that their abundance may also supply your needs, that there may be equality. As it is written, whoever had much did not have more, and whoever had little did not have less. The word of the Lord.
Touched his cloak.
She said, "If I but touch his clothes, I shall be cured." Immediately her flow of blood dried up. She felt in her body that she was healed of her affliction. Jesus, aware at once that power had gone out of him, turned around and cried and asked, "Who has touched my clothes?" But his disciples said to him, "You see how the crowd is pressing upon you, and yet you ask, 'Who touched me?'" And he looked around to see who had done it. The woman, realizing what had happened to her, approached in fear and trembling. She fell down before Jesus and told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has saved you. Go in peace and be cured of your affliction." While he was still speaking, people from the synagogue official's house arrived and said, "Your daughter has died. Why trouble the teacher any longer?" Disregarding the message that was reported, Jesus said to the synagogue official, "Do not be afraid. Just have faith." He did not allow anyone to accompany him inside except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. When they arrived at the house of the synagogue official, he caught sight of a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. So he went in and said to them, "Why this commotion and weeping? The child is not dead, but asleep." And they ridiculed him. Then he put them all out. He took along the child's father and mother and those who were with him and entered the room where the child was. He took the child by the hand and said to her, "Talitha kum," which means, "Little girl, I say to you, arise." The little girl, the child of 12, arose immediately and walked around. At that, they were utterly astounded. He gave strict orders that no one should know this, and said that she should be given something to eat. The Gospel of the Lord. That we're all afraid of death.
think we're afraid of our own death. We think about it because we don't know how it will happen, an accident, old age, or illness. We're afraid of our own death because we think, will it hurt? Will it be painless? Will I die alone, or will someone be there to comfort and reassure me? Where will I go after I die? Up there, down there, somewhere in between. More than our own death, though, I think we're very much afraid of the death of someone we love. Our mother, father, sister, brother, God forbid a child, a dear friend. We start to think, will we see each other again? Will we be together again? Will we laugh and cry and fight and argue and hug and kiss? And all those wonderful things that we do in life, what happens when someone we love dies? We're left with that question. There's a kind of emptiness, a pain, an ache, sadness. And we wonder, will we be together again? We feel very profoundly the pain that comes from separation. Separation from those we love because of death. And we wonder, what now? We're afraid. Fear. The two interwoven stories that we hear in Mark's gospel today couldn't be more different. The contrasts, the differences are pretty clear. There's a young girl, and an old woman. There's sudden death and a long, lingering death. We take the two people of today's gospel, the young girl and the woman with the hemorrhage. One is touched, and the other reaches out to touch. One has family. Whole synagogue community, and one is alone, isolated, on the periphery, on the margins. One is just beginning life, and one is in the ending days of her life. One is in the center of all of the worry and anxiety, emotion, activity, and one is on the periphery, on the edge of it all. One is sought out, and the other is seeking. You might ask yourself, there's so much that is different about these two. So much that's different. What might they have in common? We come to easy conclusions when we think about it. We jump to easy conclusions like faith and trust and confidence and belief. But I think there's something more. What they have in common is death is very near. Inescapable. Undeniable, might think inevitable. That death is very, very, very close. It makes us think about the many facets and dimensions of death, kind of the texture of death, because death just isn't one thing. It isn't one experience. It isn't just one understanding that we have of death. Death is physical, certainly, and that's easy. That's one we think of quickly, right away, physical death. But death is an experience sometimes of emotion. It can be a psychological death. Spiritual death can be personal, can be communal. It can be so many different things, so many different experiences. The gospel today presents two dead people, a young girl and a woman with a hemorrhage. They're both dead. The young girl physically dead. And her death has dramatic and tragic consequences for the synagogue official. Because in the Jewish mind, in Jewish tradition, you live on
and the memory of your children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren, that your descendants remember you. That's how you are resurrected. That's eternal life. And so the synagogue official is not just thinking about his daughter's life, he's thinking about his own life. No one will remember him. This is it. If she dies, it's over, not just for her, but for him and his family, because no one will remember. That's what the Hebrew scriptures are all about. If you think of the remembering of individuals and particular communities through the ages, through the centuries, the Hebrew scriptures are all about eternal life. Eternal life is just that I remember. And the synagogue official said, I will be remembered. And then there's the death of the woman with the hemorrhage, who's lost probably all of her savings, whatever resources she had at the hands of doctors. Says she suffered at the hands of many doctors, and don't we all? It's so many things. Financially and otherwise. But she's dead. Her death is not a physical death. Her death is a social, psychological, emotional, or communal experience. That is, she's cut off, she's marginalized, she has no worth, no value in society. She has no value, so much so that she cannot even approach Jesus directly. She indirectly, sneaking up to Jesus. And I don't know if you saw, that movie, The Passion of the Christ, where she actually crawls on the ground. She's at ground level, crawling on the ground, reaching out to touch the tassel of Jesus' cloak. But she has no worth, no value. She's dead already. Society has no place for her. The synagogue community has no place for her. Death is near. But that's not all. Something happens in both instances, in the experience of both people. Death is near, but then there is a death-defying action, a gesture. Death is stared down. Death is put in its place, so to speak. That's right, a death-defying action takes place. A woman touches the tassel of the master's cloak, and the master reaches out and grabs the hand of a little girl and says, arise. Death-defying actions. When all hope is lost, when it seems like the end is near, nothing can be done. It's over, it's done, it's finished. This is the final chapter. It would be easy just to say, as a synagogue official hears those words, okay, let's go home and we'll prepare for burial. It would be easy, after 12 years of struggle, to give up and to say, okay, no more, I can't take it, let me die a physical death. Because I can't take this long, lingering death anymore. How easy it would be to say, okay, just let me die. Many today say that religious life is in its autumn years. I don't know if you've heard people say that, but inside and outside of religious life, and all that's going on in our world today, many people look at religious life and they say, what? We're in our end times, our autumn years. They say clearly, religious life is dying. I had a confrere that said, I don't know why we have chapters anymore, because it's just like rearranging the deck chairs on the Titanic. I remember I was at Visitation Parish for 6 years in Kensington, and we had a wonderful gentleman there. His name is Jim Blatsky. He's passed away since. He had a terrific Philadelphia voice. And he was a lector. And the lectors, at the beginning of the celebration of the Massive Sunday, would get up and make an announcement and give a welcome. And we were tithing in the parish. And I wanted, at the beginning of every Mass, that the lector would get up and welcome the people and remind everybody, we are a tithing parish. So Jim Blonsky would get up there. He always was at the Saturday evening mass at 5 o'clock. He would get up there and give the announcements, and he would say, welcome to Our Lady of the Visitation Parish. We are a dying parish. So please use your envelope. Well, I thought he was saying dying, but he was really saying tithing. Which is hard to distinguish. But we look at a lot of our ministries, our parishes, even our life as religious, and we see all that's going on around us, and what do we see? Decay? Dissolution? Diminishment? I never was in a pulpit that you could drive. It has pedals, and now I know you can steer it. I'm sorry, that just caught me off guard. I was like, where are we going now? But when we think about religious life, isn't that it? Everybody talks about decay, diminishment. All around us is decline. We can't live religious life as a near-death experience. We can't. Even though we see things happening around us, even though the words of others tell us so, that death is very near, we cannot live our life, our vowed life, as a preparation, a constant and continual preparation for death. No, we cannot. And consequently, chapter cannot be viewed as palliative care, or we're going into hospice, and we need to make sure that we are as comfortable as possible, and that we make our death as painless as possible. No, we cannot do that. Many think we should. Maybe even people here. The chapter is just that. Let's make ourselves comfortable. Let's do what we can. Let's just get by as we go through this long, lingering, slow, and painful process of going into the sunset. Sure, we have to pay attention to the Passover mystery. That is true. We must do that. Pay attention to the dyings and risings in religious life. The dying and rising that we live daily, personally and communally, and throughout the years, especially as we live in between chapters, to pay attention to the daily dying and rising, how our lives are patterned on the life of Jesus, who suffered, died, and rose. Certainly we must do that, but we get stuck on Good Friday, we get stuck on death, and when everybody around us is saying death, it's so easy to say, I give up. I don't want to do anymore. Let's just go gracefully into the sunset. God did not make death. And so, chapter, I like to think of it like this. God is doing something in us, and we take a moment to stop and think about and pray about what that is. God is doing something, and sometimes we can be too busy to notice it. Sometimes we can be too preoccupied with other things, and we don't notice what God is doing. I watch Chopped. It's mindless television that I eat sometimes. You don't have to think about anything when you watch Chopped. You just watch them make food. And then after you watch a few episodes, because they run them in a row, then you eat. I do. So I watch Chopped, and I come to see as I watch. Do you know what Chopped is? Everybody knows it's on the Food Network. It's a competition. They have raised cooking to the level of sport. It's really great. So there's a competition. You have four chefs or people in the cooking profession somehow, and they compete against each other with secret ingredients, and they'll win a basket. Do you know, I figured out, if you never taste your food, you always lose. I noticed that what the chapter told us to do, what we said we want to do, and then it's not in taste. To see if it tastes good, what needs to be added, what's missing. To savor what God is doing. Don't be afraid. Chapter is a death-defying act. Chapter is reaching out and touching the hem of the garment of the Master. Chapter is having the Master come to you and say, stand up, arise. Chapter is a proclamation, or rather a profession of faith in eternal life and in the resurrection. The dead does not have the final word. That God is doing something. That God is acting. That God is present. That God is working. And working toward new, abundant, more, and everlasting life. In chapter, the story of each individual sister is connected to the story of Teresa Maxis and the founding sisters and that vision. And that founding vision touches the gospel and the story of Jesus and his disciples. And the story of Jesus and the disciples touches the church. The story of the church touches the world. It's a death-defying act to participate in chapter. Because what it says is Teresa Maxis is alive. What it says is Jesus and his disciples are alive. What it says is your sisters are all alive. And why? Because Jesus is present. And you in chapter, in a death-defying act, reach out and touch the Lord. And in return, the Lord reaches out and touches you. And says, Talitha cum. Don't die. In other words, rise. And so, sister, servant of the Immaculate Heart of Mary, Talitha cum. Sisters, servants of the Immaculate Heart of Mary, Talitha cum. I tell you, Jesus tells you, stand up, get up, rise, and do not be afraid. Because just as God has done wonderful, awesome, great, and powerful things in you in the past, God wants to and will do wonderful, great, awesome, and powerful things through you today and tomorrow and into the future. Don't be afraid. Touch the Lord and hear the Lord say to you today, I tell you, arise.
Let us pray and trust.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who hold public office, that they act with wisdom, compassion, and integrity. Let us pray and trust.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the well-being of immigrants and migrants, that they may be united with their family members and be given a chance to prosper in safety and peace. Let us pray and trust.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For parents who have suffered the death of a child, for all who are grieving the loss of loved ones, that they be strengthened and comforted by the support of friends and the love of Christ. Let us pray and trust.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those suffering chronic illness or long-term disability, that they may persevere in their struggle for wellness and their faith in Christ, and for God's blessing on all in the medical field, that the divine physician accompany them in their skilled care. Let us pray and trust.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For each member of this sacred assembly, that as we journey together through the days ahead, we may delve deeper into the mystery of God's redeeming love. Let us pray and trust.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For each member of all three branches of the IHNs, for the Oblate Sisters of Providence, the Sisters of St. Joseph, and the Redemptorist Congregation, that our deeds will witness to God's providence in our lives of consecration, mission, and joy. Let us pray and trust. For the souls of all who have died, that they may rest in the healing and new life of the kingdom, let us pray and trust.
We praise you, Father, for our Savior Jesus Christ, who enlightens us in his gospel. Keep us faithful to his word in this life, to live in your kingdom of light forever and ever.
Amen.
my sacrifice and yours will be acceptable to God the Almighty Father.
Let the sacrifice at your hands.
God, who graciously accomplished the effects of your mysteries, grant, we pray, that the deeds by which we serve you may be worthy of these sacred gifts. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For you so loved the world that in your mercy you sent us the Redeemer, to live like us in all things but sin, so that you might love in us what you love in your Son, by whose obedience we have been restored to those gifts of yours that by sinning we had lost in disobedience. And so, Lord, with all the angels and saints, we too give you thanks, as in exaltation we acclaim. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
Thank you.
and the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension to heaven. And as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles, glorious martyrs, with Teresa Maxis, with Louis Gelée, and all those in glory, with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, Charles, our Bishop, the Order of Bishops, all the clergy, the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you in their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom we bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever.
Thank you.
Behold the Lamb of God, our most holy Redeemer. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go forth, the Mass is ended.
Thanks be to God.